10, we were doing the chapter Nelson Mandela on that day, right? So we have studied that how he has learned to overcome fear. Okay. So according to him, what is courage? So what was courage according to him? Courage is not only what it is. It is not absence of fear, but actually it is a triumph. It is a victory over courage. Okay. So he has learned about it. Okay. But finally, after that, he has come up to the main point that in his lifetime, he has mentioned that there are two kind of obligations. Which are the two different kind of obligations? Which are two different kind of obligation? One obligation was towards his family. A person always has towards his family, towards his, it is towards his family, towards his wife, towards his children, towards his parents, towards his relatives. Okay. He has to protect them. He has to provide them all that is what required and which is much essential to them. Right. And the other, you can say obligation, the duty a person always has towards his, you can say countrymen, towards his, you can say nation, which he has to fulfill. But he said a man like him is always, you can say, is always forced to deliver, not to deliver both his obligations together. He should stop to deliver, or he is delivering only one of his obligation. Okay. He said he tried to be a good husband. He tried to be a good child also, to take care of his parents. But what has happened to him? But what has actually happened? It has happened that he was not able to fulfill both of these obligations, because while he was fulfilling his duty towards his nation, his other obligation, it has been ripped away from him, and he was forced to live a life of separation. Okay, what kind of life he was supposed to live? He was forced to live a life of separation. Okay, and he was pretended, and he was prevented from fulfilling both these type of obligations. Okay, like that is of a son, a father, as well as a husband. So, talking about freedom, what he has said, can anybody tell me? Talking about freedom, what he has thought? Anybody remembers? For freedom, you remember what he has thought? So, what he has said, that he said that he has hunger for freedom. What he has, that he has hunger for freedom. Okay. So, when he was a young child, he thought that running in the fields, swimming in a stream of water, and or you can say cooking mealies is under the stars, this is freedom for him. Okay. But later on, he has come to know that when he is, you can say, he has grown up, he thought that to obey the customs, okay, rituals of the tribe, this is also, of course, you can say freedom. But he said, but actually his freedom, it has been ripped away from him. His freedom, it has been taken away from him. Okay. So for that, what has happened? He was not able to enjoy freedom. Later, when he has turned out to be a young boy, okay, he thought reading the book of his own kind, spending night with his friends, okay, this is, of course, freedom. And when he has turned out to be a young boy, okay, in his youth, he thought that spending a night out with his friends is a freedom, to go wherever he wants his freedom. But when he was trying to get a job in Johannesburg, at that time he has come to know that his freedom is actually ripped away from him. How his freedom is taken away from him? Why? It is because of the reason that he has to struggle enough to earn his keep according to his, you can say, to earn his keep according to his, you can say, caliber, according to his, you can say, capability. Then he has come to know that his freedom is no longer his freedom. It has already been taken away from him. Okay. So this developed in Nelson Mandela a hunger for freedom. He wanted to attain freedom. He wanted to get freedom, of course. Okay. So what he has thought, he has come to know also that his brothers and sisters, they were also not free. Okay. They were also, until and unless they are not free, he won't. as his, you can say brothers and sisters here. Brothers and sisters refers to his countrymen. Okay, till they are in chains, he is of course in chains, and he has to, you can say, face all these kind of obstructions that they were facing. Okay, so this is, it is just because of his, this you can say, knowledge, that after that he has joined African National Congress. So what, he has joined African National Congress, and this has developed in him the hunger for freedom. What has been developed? This developed in him the hunger for freedom. Okay, so he has said that this has brought a lot of change in his life. How it has brought a lot of change in his life? That he has come out to be from a law-abiding attorney. He has turned out to be a criminal. Okay, and from, you can say, family-loving husband, he has turned out to be a man without home. He became a homeless wanderer, moving from one place to another. Okay, so in this man, he thought himself that freedom is actually indivisible. Okay, and if the chains are there on any one of his people, those chains are actually upon him. He has to overcome these kind of shackles. He has to overcome these kind of chains in order to free himself. So this is exactly what he wants. He wanted to get himself separated from those. Okay? Right? So after that, he has also come in the end of the chapter to two main things. That is the one who is oppressed and the another one who is oppressing. Okay? So what he is saying, the oppressed and the oppressor one. So he said that both these persons, either he is oppressed or the oppressor one, they are not free. The oppressed, the person who is oppressed, he is not free. Why he is not free? Because he is under the burden. He is under the chains of the oppressor. Okay. And how oppressor is not free? Because he is ruling one, still he is not free. How he is not free? Because he is, you can say, he is under the burden of his own negative thoughts. He is under the burden of his own thoughts. He is the prisoner of hatred. And in order to overcome this kind of hatred, he has to work hard. So this is the main thing that he has told about oppressed as well as the oppressor. Right? So till here, this is all for Nelson Mandela that we have revised. So any doubt if you have, you can ask me. Any doubt to any child? That's fine. That's clear. So now, let me discuss some of the questions from the chapter, extra questions from the chapter. So first is, what does courage mean to Nelson Mandela? What does courage mean to Nelson Mandela? Who will tell me, what does courage mean to Nelson Mandela? Yes, Vineet, what does courage mean to Nelson Mandela? Anyone from the online class? Raise up your hand if you know the answer. What does courage mean to Nelson Mandela? Courage actually, according to Nelson Mandela, means he has got a new definition of courage. Sit down. From the type of sacrifices, from the various sacrifices which are made by his ancestors, he has come to know that courage does not mean absence of fear. Okay, courage does not mean absence of fear, but what actually courage is? Courage is triumph. Courage is victory over it. Okay, so what does courage mean? Courage means victory over fear. Okay, you have to overcome your fear. Right? So, what were the two obligations does Mandela mention? So what two obligations does Nelson Mandela has mentioned? What two obligations he has mentioned? One was towards his? Yes, another towards his nation. So according to Nelson Mandela, every person has to fulfill two obligations in his life. One towards his family, towards his wife, towards his children, towards his parents. Okay? And the other obligation is towards, you can say, towards your nation. Okay, towards your nation. Okay, that person is obliged to fulfill both these obligations. But he said that a man like him, he is ripped away from his family when he is fulfilling his other obligation towards his nation. It means that he is no longer allowed to fulfill both these obligations at one time. Okay, he is fulfilling only one obligation at a time. Okay, what being free mean to Nelson Mandela when he was a young child? Being free, what does being free mean to Nelson Mandela? To ride the backs of the bulls, to cook mealies under the stars, to freely swim in the stream of water, okay, to run in the fields as a young boy. This means freedom to him. But when he has grown up, how does this definition of freedom, it has changed for Nelson Mandela? How this definition of freedom has changed for Nelson Mandela? Yes. Yes. Freedom. Yes. How it changed for Nelson Mandela when he has grown up? Earlier he was thinking running on the back of a bull or having a dip in the stream is freedom. But later on, yes, getting a job according to his caliber. It means when he has grown up, yes, equal rights. Very good. Simple one is equal rights. That when a man is struggling to fight for equal rights, then this is what? This is called as? This is what? Then this is called as, you can say, freedom. And he said, at that moment, his definition of freedom has altogether changed for him. He wanted to get himself free. And for this reason, what is there? That he was trying to earn his livelihood according to his caliber. But he was not getting. At that moment, he has come to know that his freedom is actually not the freedom which he is thinking or what he is feeling. Actually, not only he, but also his friends, brothers and sisters, they were also devoid of this kind of freedom. They are also devoid of this kind of freedom. Next. Next is, how did Mandela's understanding of freedom changed with age and experience? This I have clearly explained to you. Next, how did Mandela's hunger for freedom change his life? How his hunger for freedom changed Mandela's life? First of all, how he developed his hunger for freedom? He was born free. He has different notion of freedom when he was a boy. When he has grown up, when he was struggling to earn his keep according to his caliber, at that time he has come to know that he is no longer free. Moreover, his brothers and sisters, they are also in shackles. Clear? So what he has said, so what he has thought, that actually what freedom is, that he is now no longer free. Freedom is equality in rights. And for that purpose, what he has done, he has joined Indian National Congress. But this hunger of freedom has changed his life. How it has changed his life? He has turned from a family-loving man to a homeless man. Okay, he has turned from a law-abiding attorney to a criminal. And from, you can say, from a free person to a person spending long times in jails and in seclusion as well as lonely life. So this is how his life has altogether changed. And this is just because of his hunger for freedom. That his hunger for freedom has changed his life a lot. Okay. Next, what ideals does he set out for his future or for his future of South Africa? What ideals he has set out? What he thought for future of set out of South Africa? He has thought that for him. People will not at all suffer. They should be free. They should not. Yes, the black, they will be free from apartheid. Okay, no discrimination. And moreover, they will not face any kind of, you can say, deprivation. Okay, they will not suffer any kind of deprivation. They would be free to protect the rights of all, to take care of all. Okay, and moreover, for him, what is actually? What is the wealth of his country? They are not the gems and the minerals that he has in his soil, but actually his actually wealth is the countrymen, other countrymen. Next, why were the two national anthems were sung at the same time during the inauguration ceremony? Why the two national anthems were sung? To pay respect to both the national anthems, that now they both are equal. The white were singing of blacks and blacks were singing of whites. Although they don't remember the words, but soon they will. It means that there is equality now in both of them. This is the reason why it was played in the Union buildings of Pretoria during the oath taking ceremony of Nelson Mandela. Okay. So now with this, the discussion of chapter of Nelson Mandela is complete. And now I am taking the revision of the poem Dust of Snow. Okay. So now the poem. Who is the poet? Dust of Snow. Who is the poet? Robert Frost. Poet of nature. Robert Frost is the poet of nature. Okay. So in Dust of Snow, what is the main theme? Can anybody tell me what is the main theme of the poem, The Dust of Snow? Yes. So what happened in this poem, that snowflakes, when the poet is sitting under which tree he was sitting? Hemlock tree. He was sitting under hemlock tree, and at that time what has happened? Snowflakes, they have fallen onto the poet, and it has changed his mood from a rude one to a happy one. Okay. So the poet is bringing out the significance of the small events in our life, that even the small events in our life, they are also very important. Moreover, he is also bringing out the communication between the nature and human. Okay, what he is bringing out? The communication between nature as well as human. And moreover, nature is always having a healing effect upon human beings. How it has healing effect? Because it has healed up the mood of the poet. Okay, he thought that my entire day it has been spoiled. Okay, but what has happened? It has not been spoiled. Okay, he has started again with a new zest, with a new, you can say, energy. And this is how it has been brought out in this poem. So let us see the explanation. The way a crow shook down on me. So while sitting, it was a winter frosty day. The entire landscape, it was covered with snow. All the trees, they were covered with snowy flakes. And the poet was sitting under a hemlock tree. And what happened at that time, a crow perched onto the branch of a hemlock tree. And while he came and sat onto the branch of a hemlock tree, and that moment what has happened, that few snowflakes, it has fallen onto the poet and has given my heart. So here there is repetition of sound H. So this is an example of consonants. Okay, because H is repeated, it is a consonant sound. Moreover, it is not repeated in consecutive words. It is repeated by occurring gaps in between. So this is the example of consonants. So, and has given my heart a change of mood. And what has happened? That this has brought about a change in his heart. So what has happened, that this has brought about a change in his heart, in his mood also. And He thought that my particular day, it has entirely been destroyed. It has entirely been, you can say, suffered. He has suffered. Okay. But what has happened? And saved some part. Again, saved some part. A repetition of S and S is there. This is also an example of consonants, right? Consonants. And there is, you can say, see, has given my heart a change of mood and saved some parts of a day I had rued. There are lines which are rhyming with each other in the paragraph. So there is also use of internal rhyme in the passage or in the paragraph. So clear? What is there? Their use of internal rhyme in the passage or in the paragraph. So moreover, what is there? The poet is saying, and saved some part of a day I had reaped. And he said, when those snowflakes, they have fallen onto me. Okay. When these snowflakes, they have fallen onto him, he has thought that his day is not completely a waste. His day, it has not completely been destroyed, but some part it has been saved as well as preserved. So the hemlock tree, which is otherwise considered to be as a sign of negativity, even the crow, because wherever in English literature, hemlock tree as well as crow is used, they are examples of what? They are examples of, you can say, negative emotions, negativity. Okay, but here the poet is, you can say, attaching something positive with hemlock tree as well as that of crow. Because while sitting under the branch of a tree, okay, when the snowflake has fallen upon him, why this snowflake has fallen upon the poet? Because of the crow who has perched on the branch of a tree. Okay, so when it has fallen, so what has happened? He was rejuvenated with new kind of energy. He was filled with newness in his life. So the poet has attached them with positivity in life. Okay. So throughout this poem, there is use of enjambment. What is enjambment? Can anybody tell me what is enjambment? What is enjambment? Remember? No. Enjambment means when there is no use of any punctuation marks, especially full stop and comma at the end of the line, but the idea of the line, it is carried forward onto the next lines. This is what? This is called as enjambment. What is this? This is called as enjambment. For example, the very first line, the way a crow swooped down on me. The way a crow represents the way how crow came and sat on the branch of a tree. Okay. And second is shook down on me means he has thrown a, you can say, snowflake onto the poet. Okay. So what does this is example of? This is an example of enjambment. Okay. Moreover, has again the dust of snow from a hemlock tree. It means the dust of snow as well as the hemlock tree, they are, both these lines are attached to each other. So these are examples of enjambment. And the similar way in the next two, next four lines in that of the next paragraph. See, has given my heart a change of mood. Again, there is use of enjambment. Then and saved some part of a day I had rued. Again, there is use of enjambment. Okay, there is again use of enjambment. So throughout the poem, internal rhyme is used as well as enjambment. So main theme, I have also told you what is the main theme. That is communication between nature and human is very important. Nature is always having healing touch, or nature is always extend its healing hands towards human beings. And moreover, the poet is also highlighting the significance of small events. That those small events, they are very, very important in our life. Okay? So if we want to justify the title of the poem, how we will justify? Dust of Snow. Why the name of the poem is Dust of Snow? The title is appropriate because the poet has given the importance of the snowflakes which has fallen onto him and has changed his mood. It has changed his mood from a sad one to a happy one. Okay. He thought that the day has been destroyed. But ultimately what has happened? His day has been saved. So the title is appropriate. So what is the symbolism? Symbolism used in the poet. Symbolic what? Crow as well as hemlock tree, they are symbolic of negativity, negative thoughts. But the poet has attached positive feelings, positivity with these two things. Okay, so what is there? We can't say that they are negative, that they are actually signs of positivity. That nature, it always encloses positive thoughts, positive ways, and positive results for human beings. And it is only a human can always get relaxed in the lap of nature only. Right? So what is the central idea of the poem? Central idea of the poem. Again, small things, insignificance of small things, that when a crow was, sorry, the poet was sitting under a hemlock tree, then what has happened? That a crow came, perched on the branch of a tree, snowflakes has fallen onto him. And what has happened? This has brought a change in his mood. Okay. So this is how, right? Nature always has helping as well as healing hand for us. So write in context to that of poem. So nature is always having healing as well as positivity in his, you can say, in disguise. And it is only we human beings who need to understand it. Otherwise, nature is always coming up with, you can say, number of, you can say, bounties for us that we have to enjoy. Okay. So nature is always having a helping as well as healing touch for human beings. And with this, the discussion of the poem is also over. Okay, so if you have any doubt, you can raise up your hands now. Yes, Bhumika, any doubt?
Ma'am, is the meaning of internal rhyme and central idea same?
What is the internal rhyme? When the ending words of each line, they rhyme with each other. This is internal rhyme. Central idea means what the poet wants to deliver through this poem. Okay, right? So again, 10th class, I'm repeating, those who haven't sent the notebooks, send it to me till evening, okay? Or means today positively, and tomorrow I'm going to finalize the list. Otherwise, I'm not going to allot the marks. So that's all for today. And tomorrow we will start with the discussion of the next chapters.